Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 61 of Kim's Upholstery Live. As you come in this afternoon, go ahead and say hello. Give us a thumbs up so that we know you're out there watching. And you know we always love to see where you're viewing from as well. Now, if you've been watching the last few weeks, or maybe you've been watching all 61 episodes, I'm not sure. We've been working on this chair project for 3 or 4 weeks now, and we started with the bare frame. The springs had already been done, and we've been going through building it up. And this week, we're heading towards the finish line, and we're going to be finishing up the tops of the arms, which still need to be padded and then have the decorative fabric put on them. And then we're going to get started with putting on our decorative gimp. This chair before had all kinds of tacks. It had a gazillion tacks going on, and I am going to use tacks again, but not as many as they had. And I was going back and forth with myself on whether to use a double welt cord or whether to use the decorative gimp. And I just thought there's so much going on this chair already that I wanted to go with the gimp and then add a few decorative tacks. Like I said, I'm not going to fill it in as thickly as they had it before. And I went back and forth on whether to do a colored gimp to pick out one of the colors from the chair, but I decided to go with a neutral that matches the background, and that way I felt that the print would stand out. And if you remember, we've got this green going on the outside back, and I just thought there was enough going on with those two combinations and the addition of the tacks that I'm going to put on here. So again, as you come in, go ahead and say hello. Let us know where you're viewing from. And as always, we love it when you hit that share button and send it out to your page so your friends can come on over here with us and see what we're doing here on Kim's Upholstery. Because we do have a good time, don't we? I think so. At least I do. So the first thing I'm going to do is try to get my stool to turn the way I want, is to pad with cotton. So I've got, it's probably hard for you to see, but these areas are quite tiny, but we're going to pad it with cotton, use Dacron, and then fabric on top of it. But before I get going, let me go ahead and say hello to you, because I see several of you have popped in already this afternoon. We've got James from Mississippi. Hi, James. Hello, Tracy. Hello, Diana. Hi, Joan, Peggy, Jan, Amy, Elda, Joanne, another Diane, and hello everybody. Wow, we've got Florida and Texas and Uruguay and Alabama and Virginia and Pennsylvania. So we've got people from all over the place, and that's always fun for me to see where people come in to live. And we've got people out on YouTube as well coming in, so we're here in both places. On Facebook, you can share hitting the share button. On YouTube, you have to kind of go outside, I think, and share. And we've got Robert here from Alaska. Hey, Robert, all the way from Alaska. It's one of those states that I want to get to someday. So is anybody saying what they're working on? I don't see any projects coming up. So I'm going to go ahead and we'll get started with this. And like I said, I'm going to use cotton first. And then I'm going to use the Dacron on top of it. Oftentimes people ask me when I'm padding things why I don't use foam. I personally like the effect that I can get from cotton in the Dacron, so I typically pad pretty much everything I work on with that combination of padding. On a situation with the arms here, you could use a half inch or maybe even a 1 inch foam, depending on how puffy you wanted them to be, and then go over it with Dacron. But let's go ahead and let me grab some of my cotton. And my staple gun. So this is where all those scraps that you have laying around come in handy. And you'll notice that my cotton is white. In case you're new here, we use the synthetic cotton. I prefer that over the 100% natural cotton. And it's the cleanliness of it. I had an issue years and years ago where the seed pods from the cotton actually created oil spots on my fabric on a deck. So ever since then, I've gone strictly to the synthetic cotton, and nobody else out there has ever had that happen but me, so I think it was a freak accident. But typically, I go over it with Dacron anyway, so that's not a danger. So if you're using the natural cotton, don't feel like you have to switch to synthetic. It's what you're comfortable working with. So I'm going to go ahead and put some small pieces, and we're going to build this up. Is everybody recovered from the holiday madness with the shopping? If you went out and shopped on Black Friday and Cyber Monday, you wouldn't have to go out. You would have stayed at home, but I haven't even started my Christmas shopping yet, I hate to say. I've been giving it a lot of thought, but I haven't done any physical shopping yet. I know that some people get so stressed going out and do that. One year, my daughters and I and a couple of my nieces all decided that we were going to go out. It was one of the first years I think they started doing the, you know, shopping at midnight on Thanksgiving Day. And so we went out, I think, at 2:30 in the morning and went to the mall shopping. And what a nightmare. People were grumpy and miserable and pushing each other. And I'm like, never again am I doing that. Clerks were okay, but it was the shoppers. And of course, they were all women. It's like, they can get pretty grumpy. All right, so there's two layers on there. I think I'm going to go ahead and put one more layer. I want it a little bit rounded. These arms are pretty flat, so you can create your roundness by your padding, which is what I'm going to do here. I don't want them to be too full, but I also want them to be soft if someone like rests their elbows on them. So, and I'm not going down over the sides, as you can see. I'm keeping it on the top pretty much right now. I'm keeping the area where the gimp will go clear. Padding. So just what the torn edges are that are hanging is what's going down the side. I haven't added a lot of padding down the edges, but we will bring the dacron down on the side. So let me go ahead and spin this around. What do you know? My footrest is right in front of me, my lift button here. Oftentimes it's not where I am. So let's see. If I turn this way, you can probably see a little bit better. So is anybody working on any fun projects? I know if you're in the business, you're probably getting all those holiday scheduled projects for your clients done. All right. So, and with the cotton, you don't have to cut it. You don't have to be precise. It's just tearing it down to the correct size that you need. Sometimes I see students will grab like scissors and start cutting it, and you really don't need to. It tears so easily. Hey, Carol, and we've got Berkeley. Carol's making a pillow. Let's see, Bethany is watching from a hair salon, so you must be getting your hair done. I get my hair done Thursday. Actually, that's tomorrow, isn't it? Hey, Bonnie. And hello, Rhonda from Colorado, and Marsha from Arkansas. And we've got Sharon. Rhonda says, I'm working on a chaise with fun bird fabric. You've been working on some really pretty stuff lately, Rhonda. I saw the picture of that fabric and the fact that you had posted that that came apart into two sections, which actually makes your life much easier working on that. And hello, Debbie and Lorinda. Thanks for joining us. And we've got Danita from Texas. Finishing two client jobs and taking the rest of the year off. Good for you, Bonnie. I wish I could say that. My plan was to pound out some work and take most of the month of December off, but I kind of goofed off in between a little bit too much, so I can't do that now. Bill's making a face at me like, really? I had wanted to do that. But I have to say, I stopped promising jobs to clients for Christmas a long time ago because, you know, I realized that there's always that last minute person who needs something done, but it's like you just stress yourself out if you commit to too much for the holidays. So you're doing good doing that. Taking some time off to relax and enjoy. All right, so now I have three layers of cotton on both arms, and I still want to always check and make sure that they feel the same, because sometimes you'll have one layer that's a little thicker than the other. But those are feeling really good. So I'm going to go ahead and get this cotton out of the way and grab my scrap of dacron that I have over here. And like I said, you save all these scraps, you don't know what to do with them, and sometimes you get to use them up, and sometimes I get so many I end up just trashing them and throwing them in the garbage. All right, this one is feeling a little bit too wide because it's going down further than I want it to, so I'm going to go ahead and tear that back a little bit because I left this side a little bit wide. All right, that's better because now I can feel the decorative wood underneath here when I go ahead and tear that off. So now what I need to do is cut this to the right length and make sure it's not so wide that when I come down on the bottom, it's going below the arm. Because this arm actually has a row of decorative wood at the bottom edge of the arm right here. So, all right, so let's go ahead and get this cut. Use my tape measure and get a measurement so I can make sure I'm getting in the right ballpark here. and not cutting the seat of my chair is a good thing too. Usually I cut all this stuff at a table, but being on camera, we'll just do it right here and I'll be extra careful. Because that would not be a good thing at this point. I might cry right on camera if I did that. All right, and this is the fuzzy cotton attached. This is the 1 ounce stake round that I prefer to use. It's, you know, up to you which size you want to use. This is just my preference. Oops, put it in the right direction is a little bit helpful too. Get some staples. This piece of red thread showing up from I don't know where. Pulling it tight. Alright, and I'm going to spin this around a little bit and I'm going to get on this little stool and get underneath the arm sort of so that I can make sure I'm getting the staples here where I want. Now this is my newest invention that one of my students, I don't know if you guys can't see it, I'm sitting on a office chair that we've taken the back off of it so that it's more comfortable and I can roll around the furniture and I'm finding it really handy. One of my students said that that's what she did and I had an old chair, so I said, what the heck, let's take it apart and give it a try. And it was a really handy, I think it was actually Joan that told me that. Yeah, so you can see, if you're looking over my shoulder here, you can probably see that you've got the decorative wood trim right here on the bottom edge, and then up above it is where I'm stapling. So it's like cut a little bit deeper here on the area where I'm anchoring to, and then this little lip sticks out further. So it gives you can feel it as you go, which is good. And that's when I was pushing it over the edge, I could feel I was going beyond that. So let me turn this a smidge. Now I'm going to do the same thing to the inside, which I actually probably have to get up for this, but same exact thing you just saw me do on the outside, I'm doing on the inside edge. And oftentimes you'll find when you're trying to do stuff like this that you end up having to hold your staple gun upside down, because if you go like this, I'm going to hit the chair and I can't get the staple gun down far enough. So I have to hold it upside down to get where I need it to go. All right, so let's spin the chair around and do the same exact thing to the opposite side. Here you can see that side all padded up right there, so you get the padding right on there, and then when the fabric's over it, I'll snug everything nice and smooth. But now let's go ahead and turn and do this side. So for 2018, we are planning, I told you last week, I think, that we were getting the schedule out for the 2018 workshops. So for 2018, I am planning an advanced upholstery workshop, which I know some of you have requested. But if it's something that you're interested in, go ahead and type advanced yes in the comments so we can kind of see who is interested in that kind of a class. And that will be limited to 4 students. So when we do the advanced class, it won't be 6 students as typical. But we're just trying to get some feedback to see how many people are really interested in that. I'm thinking February probably for the first one. Don't have the dates yet, but we'll get those out there. All right, so I got that. Now let's go ahead and scooch down here. And while I'm getting this next one done, whoops, helps if you sit on the stool in the right direction. It feels much more comfortable. So go ahead and hit that share button again for me if you would. This one, for some reason, seems a little bit wider, so that dacron must have been wider, tapered or whatever, and not completely the same width all the way down. So I'm going to have to trim the inside, I think. All again, I'm just stapling in that same area that we've been stapling. And the arms really don't take long to do, which is nice too. So when you get to this point, they're kind of quick. Trim that little bit of excess off because I can feel that it's a little bit too long towards the back there. Yeah, that's better. All right, and now this one is always the awkward. You've always got one side of the chair that's easier to work on, and this is the awkward side for me. Especially when you're tripping over your hose and getting it wrapped around your legs. We do have things from the ceiling for the hoses too, but on camera it just looks really strange having stuff hanging from the ceiling. So we're getting some responses for the workshop.
Oh yeah, you're going to have to hold two workshops. But we also have some other people that joined since the last time you were out, so you might want to say hi.
Okay, so hello Janice and James. And James says, just bought 20 hand-carved coffee table bases from Indonesia without tops. I'm sanding everything down and finishing them. Then I'm upholstering the tops in a dark brown leather. That sounds really nice, James. You'll have to share a picture with us when you're done. Joanne says, I'm working on a petite wingback chair for my guest room. Had a friend come stay and wanted to purchase the chair that was in there and I had reupholstered. What an excuse to work on something else. That's a great excuse. You get to sell something when a guest comes to visit. That's awesome. Hey, Donna. And hello, Saeed. I love your job very much. I also work as an upholsterer. Great. Hello, Joanne Weberdink. And okay, so we've got 1, 2, 3. I see at least 4 right here. 5, 6. I'm seeing a lot of advance. So you're right, Bill. We probably are going to have 2. And Teresa says, tufting a large antique sofa, complicated finished work. Definitely complicated. Rhonda says, I would love to come and I'm headed to St. Paul in February. I would love to be in the fall. Okay, so maybe we'll have one in the fall and one in the winter this year. Hey, Lisa. Lisa says, I'm finally able to catch a live Wednesday show. I know, we've missed you. We haven't been here for a while. Rhonda says, I'm excited to hear the details of the advanced class when you figure it out. Great, we will let you know. I have a lot of interest in Colorado, Rhonda, so maybe we'll have to get you to host one for us or help us find somebody to host one. Somebody else says, nice, thanks. Okay, I think I got all the questions. So let me, or comments rather. Yeah, and if you have questions while I'm working, please go ahead and post those too. All right, so now we have 2 arms completely padded, and I'm just one last time going to double check myself, make sure they feel the same, and they do. You can see I need to add a couple more staples on this one. So David says hello from Spain. Hey, David. Robert says, my first ever upholstery project is a 1930 settee love seat upholstered in deer hide. Ooh, that sounds like a fun project, but a complicated one for your first one. Joan says, hi, Kim. I would love to take an advanced upholstery class when I'm ready for it. Probably won't be as early as February, though. I need to get some practice in. Angela from Highland says, hi, hello. I think I got those. Okay, so a couple more staples, and then we're ready for fabric. And what I'm just doing with the last couple staples is just kind of finessing the edges at the front and back of the arms. All right, get myself untangled, spin it around here so you can see from the front. And I'll go ahead and get another staple over here on this one. All right, that staple did not go in, so it's, now it did. Whack it down. All right, so there we have it. Padded arms, ready for fabric. Now, what did Kim decide to put on here for fabric? I had a really hard time deciding how to land the print on the arms. I don't know why it was taking me so much time. But first I thought of putting the green that was on the outside back on the arms, but I thought that the embroidery would probably, if somebody used this chair a lot, which it's probably not a chair that would be used a lot, that the embroidery would wear off. So I thought that wasn't a good choice, even though I liked the idea of the color. Rhonda says, that is a great idea. Could we work out of my garage? Yes, Rhonda, we can definitely do a workshop at a garage. I've done that before. It's actually kind of fun, especially if it's warm weather. So I went back and forth. I was looking at the paisleys, and then I'm like, but if it's a big, bright fabric pattern, does it take away from it too much? Did I have another question I needed to answer? I thought I saw something fly by. Unrelated, but how is Bill doing after the carpal tunnel surgery? Thank you for asking. His hand is actually finally starting to get better, but now yesterday we scheduled surgery for the second arm. So that's in the end of January. He'll have carpal tunnel hand number two surgery. So the surgery worked well enough that he wants to have it again. So I went back and forth. I thought of, which is upside down, I thought of putting this red paisley, which I don't know if you can see that well enough, on the arm, but then I thought, well, maybe that would take away from the rest of the chair and it would be too bold. Then I thought about the purple flower, which is, I guess it's not, here it is right here. I thought about this purple flower and I wasn't sure about that. So what I decided to do was keep it simple and have the arm be less detailed. So I decided to use this yellow flower right here as my main focus. Let's see, right there. As my main focus for the top of the arm. So I'm going to incorporate that, and I'm actually thinking I might not have the fabric completely straight of grain to get it look the right way, so I was kind of playing around with that. So as I cut my pieces out, we'll decide. Although, you know what, straight of grain that way, now that it's padded, it actually looks better straight of grain. So maybe I will do that. I like that. Okay, good decision. But it took me forever to figure out placement for these little arms, which is kind of weird. All right, so there, if I cut my fabric at that point, and usually I would get measurements and go to the table and cut them out, but and figure out my center point, but we're just gonna cut out way too big a piece and then get the positioning. So that one came out of that fabric, and then the fabric over here has the same motif. And you know what, I think I'll get that one on first and then we'll cut this so that I can make sure I'm placing it in the right place before I make the cut. Although this one's got less fabric, so maybe we'll get this one on first. Let's see. Decisions are always fun. Just looking at where that lands. Actually, that's going to be perfect. I like that a lot. I also had thought of picking one of the leaves, but I didn't have two leaves that matched from the scraps that I had left. So we went with this. All right, so I know my attachment is there. I can go ahead and cut some of this off to get it out of our way. Same back here. I'm committing, can you tell? All right. Trying to decide how much of the purple do I want showing. I kind of like that. I don't know if you guys can see that well, but that looks really good. All right, let's get it stapled. Now when you do these kind of arms, you almost always have to have a pleat or two in the top of the arm. So let the fabric tell you what it wants to do. Don't force it to try to go flat, because usually it just doesn't look well when you do that. Let's go ahead and get this stapled here. And I can feel the groove, so I know that I'm staying within that. And I'm watching the grain here as I go. And you figure this arm is not only curved this way, but it's curved this way on the top too. So it's really hard to not have some sort of pleats up here on the top. One staple did yank a thread in my fabric though, so let me see if I can mess with that. There, two of them. I hate that when you hit a staple in and it pulls a thread, it makes a little tug in the fabric, which is exactly what happened, but I got it to release. Okay. So now, inside of the arm. And I want to pull it taut at this point, keep it nice and tight. We don't want it sloppy. And there is enough of a lip that I can hit my gun up against it, the nose of my gun, so that I know I'm not going too low. Okay. I go all the way to the back over here? I think I did. Gotta go a little further back on this side. Okay, so now I have both of the sides done, and now I am just going to play with the top and see where it wants to pleat. And at the front, it looks like I am only going to have a pleat on one side. This side did stay pretty straight. And I think that's going to work. So I'm just playing with the fabric and letting it tell me. I'm not forcing it to do something it doesn't want to, which usually is more detrimental to the end results. And that staple stuck right back out, so let me get that out of there. I don't know if you saw the picture I posted, I think it was yesterday, with the fabrics from Greenhouse. It did it again. There must be another staple in the wood or something. But the fabrics from Greenhouse that I've got coming up for projects and the chairs, they all arrived this morning. Those pictures were from the client's house. And they are all here now. So we're getting lots of hearts and thumbs. Thank you, guys. I'm looking at... Yeah, all right, so in the back, I'm looking like I'm going to have two pleats here. So I'm just trying to decide which way for this outside section that I want it to go. And I think what I want to do is bring the side up and have the pleat fold so it's open to the outside edge. It's looking like it's going to work better doing that. The tricky part is you get side one done and you have to make side two look exactly like it. And that sometimes is what causes the difficulties. And every once in a while, I'll have the second side look better than the first side, so then I go back and I take the first side out. So I typically will get it the way I think it looks good, do the next side, and don't trim it down until the second side's done so that I can make that decision. Especially when you're doing like pleats on the front of a rolled arm or something, oftentimes the second side looks better than the first side. So I end up revisiting the first side. There's not a big ridge here, so it's hard to kind of feel where that decorative wood is. So you really want to pay attention when you're in that kind of a situation. There you go. So it's almost in the center of the arm. And I think I can pull it just a little bit and then have a second little tiny pleat. That looks good. I like that. It's like hold it down with your fingers and staple, but don't staple your hand, right? Not always easy. Bill's had to pull several staples out of my hand, haven't you, Bill?
Yeah.
He doesn't like it when he has to do that.
Pretty sick.
Okay. I think I need one more staple in here if I can get it in that little section. Okay, I'm wishing that didn't have to be right there at the top, but I don't think there's any way to get that to shift the way the fabric is and have it look better, so I think I'm just going to have to say it's all right there. It doesn't look bad, it's just not where I would have preferred it to land, but the fabric was telling me that that's what it wanted to do. So now we'll go ahead and get the second side stapled and in place, and then we're ready to finish the trimming and start the game. I've got my glue gun warming up. Cardboard back under this foot and try to keep this chair from vibrating. So now this is the part where you really want to pay attention to where the motif lands, and it's not going to be exact where it comes off of the arm, because one's left and one's right, and this fabric is all printed, you know, you don't have a left and a right of this motif. So it's basically looking at that yellow floral and centering that in the right location. So let me see here, tape measure. It is, how far back from the back? So the center of it is at about 4 inches from the back, 3.5 from the front, and about 2.5 over the top. So 2.5 over the top would be this way. And what did I say from the back? I already forgot. 4 inches. Got it placed pretty good already. All right, so let's go ahead and get some staples in there before it shifts on me. I dropped my tape measure. Let's double check our measurements. Better to do it when I have just a few staples. Yeah, 2.5. And 4. Just double check from the front just in case. Yep, 3.5. We are good. Okay, Kim, stop stepping on your hose. Let's throw it over the chair. That way it's out of my way, maybe. Feeling that decorative wood as I go. Sometimes it's not easy to feel, but this particular chair happens to have a nice lip there, so it isn't too bad. There. All right, so in the front, so you know on this side I ended up with just one pleat. On this side it wants to go two pleats. So, see if I can force it to do one to match that side. I think I can. I think if I pop a couple staples here, I can pull that down. So I'm going to do that, but we're going to go this way. Let's see, where is that? Right at the corner. It's about, that looks good. Now let me try to get these couple staples out down here without wrecking my fabric. And then I can get those, that last little pleat to disappear on this side. Maybe. Looks like the wood really wanted to eat that staple. It was hungry. There we go. When you're at the decorative wood, too, you want to be careful with your tools that you're not squishing or pressing down into the wood, causing a divot. Come on, you get out of there. The other one didn't come up quite enough yet. There you go, it broke right in half. You can hear it snap. There you go. All right, so now it's just a matter of pulling this down a little further. Oops, that staple didn't go in. I can feel that my tool was on the in the groove, not on the decorative wood, so I was comfortable doing that. All right, so there is the front of this one. And now we're ready to do the back. So you just kind of reference yourself as to how it landed on this side. And actually, I gotta finish stapling across the back here. I didn't go all the way to the back on this side yet. So So let's take a look and see who's come in. Hey, Tammy and Nikki and Sandra and Gina and Melody and Robbie is from Florida and Winchester, Tennessee, Ohio. Got a lot of different places. You guys are coming from everywhere today. All right, got to look back at here because my memory doesn't last that long to remember exactly how I did that pleat. All right, right there. So this came this way. Pleated right there. I think I'm going to like this one better than that one. See, I told you that happens sometimes. Okay. I think I know where I'm going here. So let's... Yep, I like this side much better than the first side. So, guess that means I'm gonna pull a couple staples. Yeah, you guys can't really tell that from there, can you? Yeah.
Better angles where?
There really isn't a better angle, Bill. It's just the fabric print is so busy that you can't really see the folds from up there. But so I'm going to pop a couple staples out on this one and try to make it look more like the other one. Because this is one I didn't like very much anyway. So it's kind of happy that the other side came out different. So I'm just going to pop just the ones here in the back. Hopefully I might need to pop out one on the side, but we'll see once I get these out. Actually, I know I probably will because I think I need to shift this side down a smidge to make it look more like the other side. And of course, this is the time when all your staples break, so you have to end up clipping them off and you can't get them all the way out sometimes. Hey, that one came out. And this is when you're always nervous because it's at this point you don't want to be wrecking anything. If I have an option, I try not to aim towards like the inside back like I am right now. But in order to get these out, that's my only choice is to really go that way. So you'll notice I brace my other hand against it, which will kind of give me a better control of the tool. It's coming. There we go. Get it up enough that I can grab it. Perfect. All right, now I'm hooked on a thread here somewhere. There we go. All right, so let me look at that one. We got two little pleats, so I need to get this to come down a little bit. So I'm going to go ahead and pop a couple staples there, which I'm going to spin it around so I can sit on the stool so I can be underneath it and be at the right angle rather than trying to bend up and stand up on upside down on my head. Yes, I did tell them what the stool is, but they can't see it. It's an office chair with the back taken off. And actually, Joan Bergoni out there watching, I think it was you that told me about that. And I love it. Uh-oh, Bill's going to give you an angle of my backside so you can see the stool. Sorry for the backside, guys. But yeah, so this is the chair, and I've just taken the back off of it. And it works really awesome because it rolls really well on these wheels. Okay. Those staples lifted up pretty easily, which was nice. All right. Now I think I'm going to have to do one more staple. Let me peek at this again. Little one there, little one there. So that was like here and there. I promise I won't start singing. You wouldn't want me to sing. All right, get a staple there, get that first pleat. Okay, Joan has a question. I was there in October for an upholstery workshop with you. Not ready yet. How many pieces or what do you feel you need to have under your belt before you should consider taking an advanced class? It really depends, Joan. You can send me pictures of what you've done for chairs and we can talk about it and seeing what you've already accomplished and stuff, and then we can talk further about it. If I remember correctly, you catch on pretty quickly, so you might be ready to doing something more advanced. But let's talk about what you've already done. So send me email with pictures and we can go from there. Some people can do one or two projects and then are ready to start doing some more advanced stuff. Other people, it takes a little bit longer, and it's just how you obtain stuff and how how you work with your hands and things. It's not that one person's smarter than the other or anything. It's just we all learn differently. So there, I think I have it, but I have one more staple that I want to get out. And of course, this is one of those ones that kind of went to the other side of the arm when it went in. It's embedded just a hair. And that's one thing, when you're working on older pieces of furniture, especially if when the wood starts to get soft over time, or not soft, but just well used or something, they do seem to sink a lot further. And then also like a softer wood will do the same thing. Come on, little staple, get out of there. Got that last little piece that doesn't want to come out and it doesn't want to break off either. There we go. Got it. We won, you lost, staple. Okay, so now I'm going to go ahead and add a couple down here. And it helps if you put more staples in your gun. So I was working on that sofa that I posted pictures of the other day and using the stool, and I was like rolling from one end to the other, didn't have to get up. It was really fun. Anybody. That's okay. Everybody gets one. All right. So
my timer to wake me up. I'm starting to fall asleep.
Oh, is that what it was? All right. So the arms are all attached. I'm just going to kind of like take a look around and see if I need to add more staples, if I've got blank spots. And then we are ready to trim. Does everybody love trimming your fabric down with razor blades? What do you use to trim your fabric down when you have to do something like this? Do you use razor blades, X-Acto knives, little scissors? Let me know what you use. You use the X-Acto knife when you do it for me, right, Bill?
I do.
Yeah. Oops. That staple didn't go anywhere that it was supposed to. All right, so let's fill it in, trim it down, and start doing some hot gluing. Doing some hot gluing. That actually rhymed a little bit, right? Okay. And while I'm here, I might as well check and make sure I don't need to add anything. I already trimmed this side, though. So, inside, I'm going to bend over and you guys can stare at the back of my head for a second here. And you just want to make sure it's pretty well filled in before you start cutting, because once you've cut the rest of the fabric off, you don't have anything to pull if you've missed a spot. So let's see who else has come in while we've been working here. Hello, Elaine. Thanks for joining us. And Sherry says, Kim, are you having any classes at your place next July? I haven't completed the schedule here for next year. I'm doing the long distance ones right now, but we probably will have one somewhere around there. Joanne says Amazon has backless medical stools for about $30. That's good to know. Somebody else uses a mechanic stool. I think it might have been Donna Cash. I don't know if she's out there today. No, it wasn't Donna Cash. I don't know who it was. But anyway, it's a mechanics type stool, and then it has a tray underneath it. And I think those are pretty inexpensive, too. But I was going to throw this chair away, and so now I've repurposed it. So, hi, Tony. Thanks for joining. And hello, Patty. Patty says she uses sharp razor blades. Bonnie uses razor blades. Krista says she used the one size razor blade as you suggested, worked one sided, worked well. Yeah, you wouldn't want to use two sided with your hands. That would not work good at all. Teresa says usually a razor blade. Yeah, I use the razor blade as long as I go slow, take my time, and I also actually keep my finger like behind it, so if I slip, it's going to cut me and not the fabric, which I heal, the fabric's not going to, so for me that's okay. Very rarely do I cut myself, but because I said that, you know I probably will today, right? So let me come around this way. Let's see. And some of you may have noticed, I know some of you out there are members that are watching, and we put the new ottoman video tutorial on the website, and it was actually the ottoman with decorative trim that I did for the Country Living Fair. So that is up on the membership site now. I know a few people have watched it and are enjoying it. And we also have a new tips and techniques video out there on the membership site in the resources, and it helps you to see how to measure when you're cutting fabric for like a chair that has a funky angle or an angled back. Because oftentimes what'll happen is happened in classes with students before is they'll measure in the wrong location and then your fabric's short and you think you're getting it, but you're not looking at the fact that there's that sharp angle that makes it not what you think it is. So we get a little trick for you on how to do that and not have that oops mistake and you run out of fabric. So let's see, underneath here, I think I need a couple more staples. Even though I did trim that already. But I see a couple spots now that the light's on it. Let's see. And we're also looking for ideas. If you have specific things you'd like to see in the membership for specific content, go ahead and type in the comments here or send me an email to info@kimsupholstery.com of what type of projects you'd like to see in the membership, because we're working on that for next year. Got a couple already that I'm going to be doing. I want to do a couple more slip covers.
Yeah, I agree with A. Chandler here for sure.
So A. Chandler says, razor blades, cheap, easy to hold. The second they actually dull, they're in the coffee can. Exactly. We have a big mayonnaise jar over there with a hole in the cover, and the minute they get dull, they go right in there. Because if you're working with a dull razor blade, you're pulling even harder, and that's when you're apt to cut your fabric and make a mistake. So the minute you hit a staple or they stop cutting a clean line, get rid of them and open a new one. They're cheap enough. Okay, we are ready to do that. Speaking of razor blades, so let me just shift this out of the way. And I'm going to take a sip of water because my throat is getting dry here. Guess I'm talking too much today. You guys are keeping me talking. Okay, so where did I put my razor blades? There they are.
Kathy Hensley would like to spend a week with you. I'll have to be arranged.
That can definitely be arranged, Kathy. We do private training. So that is a possibility. So I'm going to sit down low to do this part here and along the front as well so that I can really see what I'm doing. And then I'll stand up to do the inside back. But I think I'll actually start here in this front corner. And I'm going to pump this up a little bit higher so that this is a little bit more eye level with me. When you're doing this, you really want to get at a good angle. There's nothing worse than trying to, you know, contort your body and do upholstery yoga, I call it. And then you're at a bad angle and you're not comfortable, and that's when you end up making mistakes. And I also don't do this at the end of the day. If I've been working on a project all day and I'm starting to get tired and this is the next step, I'll stop and wait till morning because you really want to be fresh. Because this is where you can wreck the whole thing. And be calling the client and saying, oh, your chair isn't going to be done because I have to order more fabric. And I'm probably not going to talk to you much while I do this because I want to pay attention. Even though this chair is for me, I don't really want to have to redo this. And I don't have any more of this fabric, so we'd be starting over from scratch with something totally different. This was one of those, I almost slipped. See, I shouldn't talk. One of those closeout deals when Greenhouse has limited inventory left and they're discontinuing They have some specials. This is one of those deals. And it was one of those things, I bought the two fabrics together, not having any idea where I was going to use them. Just said, 2 yards sounds good. I can do something with that. Now, see, that one got dull. I hit 2 staples. Done. I don't have my jar over here, so I'll have to put it in my jar after, but... So now over here on the front, I'm running into, let me turn so you can see a little better. There you go, you have to look over my shoulder. I'm running into an area where I did have some dacron peek out of it. I try not to have that happen, but sometimes it happens. And you usually can get it cut clean enough to get rid of it. And if you can't, you could pop up a few staples, use your regulator, stick it back up, and then staple it back down before you continued. But I'm confident in this particular instance that I can cut that off. There you go, see? Perfect. All right. So for an advanced class, what specific skills are some of you that said yes, you'd like to take an advanced class looking for? Just for curiosity, what kind of chairs would you want to be able to bring? I'm thinking it'll be a your choice chair, unless I really feel it's something that we can't do in the 3 days. All right, now I have one spot here where a staple is sticking out, so I'm gonna go and tap it in. Okay, so Lee is asking, where did we get the hydraulic table? Well, my beautician, I couldn't think of the word, I'm like my mom hairdresser, was redoing her shop and she was getting rid of some beauty parlor chairs. So I said, well, what do you do with them? You interested in selling them? She's like, I'm gonna throw them away, you can have them. So she gave me the chairs. But oftentimes you can get them fairly inexpensive on Craigslist when a beauty parlor is refurbishing their shop. They usually get new chairs rather than try to reupholster some of them. So just check around with that.
I got a shot up there of the base.
Okay, so Bill's got the base. So there you can see, you know, it's the beauty parlor base. I've got my foot control that I can lock it with and raise it up and down. And he just took the chair off and added a piece of plywood. So this is just a half inch plywood, half inch, Bill. And I don't know exactly what size this one is. I can actually tell you because it does work really well size wise. So this is 33 by 37. And we didn't pick that magic number for any reason. It was a scrap piece of plywood that was laying in the garage and it worked. So, you know, use whatever size works for you. I very rarely have had a chair that won't fit on this. I have had a couple times a chair that's been really close. So in that case, what I did is I actually had like an L piece of scrap wood cut out and we clamped it to the edge so that the chair wouldn't slide off because it was so close to the edge. But for like I said, for almost everything chair, obviously you can't put a sofa on these, I haven't had any problems with this size working, so. You don't want to go too big, because then what I find is, you like a small chair like this, I'm constantly pushing it from side to side because it's tiny and I need to be closer to the chair. I don't want to lean into the edge of the table here. All right, I need another new razor blade. So you do go through a lot of razor blades doing this. They do get dull. I think that's one of the hardest things in upholstery for people to get used to is the waste. I know oftentimes students come to me and they've been in the drapery world and they haven't had the experience with doing upholstery, and they're like, well, I want to save these scraps. It's like, I got too much waste. And especially when you're doing a pattern match, you have a ton of waste and you just have to kind of get over it and let it go. In fact, a client today that dropped off those chairs makes, the word will come to me. They're the quilts that have the little tiny pieces and they have the embroidery, not memory quilts. What the heck did she call them? It'll come to me in a minute. But anyway, she said, oh, I love that fabric you're working with. And I'm like, you can have all the scraps. So, you know, you find the right person, they can use the scraps. Okay, Kim, what was it? It's not a memory quilt. I know if I said the word, you'd all go, yep. So if any of you know what I'm talking about, go ahead and type the word. Okay. You know what? This baby's dull already, I think. Nope, the other edge is good.
Okay, Joanne Creco says a hairdresser gave her an old one that he had, and she wants to know how to attach it. The brackets on the hydraulic is slanted. I just use washers.
Bill used washers on ours and made up the difference, he says. Later what we can do, Joanne, is we can post a picture of it for you so that you can see what it looks like. I think we have a picture somewhere out here on Facebook of what the underneath looks like, but you know, maybe that'll help you. Where there's a will, there's a way. Bill, would you mind bringing me the container of razor blades, please? Because I'm at my last one here, I think, and it's dull. Yep, that was it. See, I thought four was going to do it, or three. Oh, there it is. I had one more. Oh, not that razor blade container. That's the old one. No, I need new razor blades.
New ones.
New ones. Sharp ones.
Get rid of the old ones.
Thank you, sir. I only call him sir because you guys are watching.
She can't say what she normally calls me.
Hey, you. All right. That last little curve. Actually, I should have turned so you guys could watch me struggle through this last little part. So, there. So I just finished going around here, and now we're ready to start on the arms. I got my pile growing on to the side where I'm throwing everything. So see, when you have a nice sharp razor blade, you can see you can just kind of keep going and it goes pretty smoothly. Now immediately it's starting to fray, that's when I know I'm getting dull already. So we are getting close to the end of the hour already, I'm realizing. So for those of you that are part of our online membership, don't forget that we will be live in the group this afternoon at 3 o'clock. And that's Eastern time for those of you in a different time zone. So bring your upholstery questions and you can come in live or you can just chat with us through the chat box that's there. So you'll need to log into your member portal and go to the live events page and then you'll see to go to today's live. And that is at 3 o'clock. And a couple of you had reached out to me earlier today asking about how to get in there. What you'll do is when we go live at 3 o'clock, I will post an active link within the chat, and there's also a link that will be underneath the video itself. So click on either of those. It'll bring you in. It may ask you for access to your camera and your mic. You just say yes, give it permission. If you've got blocker on your browser, you may not see that, and that may be why some of you have had trouble in the past getting in. So you have to go set your settings to allow your camera and mic access. Chrome works the best.
You have to log into your membership.
But you have to log into your membership, which will bring you into the portal where you can find it.
It's the only way in.
So let me go ahead and make the cuts here. Yeah, this is getting dull. I should take my own advice and change it, right? Before I struggle and make a boo-boo. It's like you always want to push it to the limit. One more cut, just one more, I'm almost there. So I don't think you guys probably want to spend a whole hour next week watching me glue on GIMP and decorative tack. So what we will probably do is I'll probably finish this chair off camera and get it done. And next week we're going to start a different project and it's going to be something for Christmas decorations. So you'll just have to wait and see next week what I do. We'll put it out there. We'll give you some ideas. But I got a couple different things going around in my head and I haven't picked exactly which one I'm going to do, but I'm leaning towards one. I hit a staple already. So let's pull out a new one. I think what I'll do is go do the other side of this chair because I really need to lay this on its side to do that inside. So, to get in the right angle. So let's see, you guys are over here. So actually, let me get this cut and then I'll show you what we're putting on here for GIMP, although I think I posted a picture of it earlier. Let's get that out of there. All right, so what I have chosen, now that I have all these razor blades all over the place, I gotta be careful. I have chosen this. Let's see, can you guys see this well enough from here, Bill? If I go this way. All right, so I've chosen this GIMP that matches the background color of the fabric, because like I said, I wanted to just stay neutral instead of having it take over and overpowering the chair. And what I have chosen for decorative tacks is, let's see if I can bring this up here, these little, camera doesn't want to focus on it.
Too close.
Too close? Yeah, it's not focusing. We'll post a picture of them. They're the little floral brass tacks. So they've got the flower design and they've got a little bit of black in the grooves of the flower, which I thought was really good because this chair has the black in the grooves of the chair. So I thought those two things together. There you go. There you go. Now you can see it. Sort of. If I could hold still, you could see it. Every time I wiggle, the camera goes out of focus. But we'll post a picture of it when it's done. So I'm gonna put the tacks on it. And if you remember, this chair was like covered with tacks. They had tacks on the inside too, which I chose not to do. If you remember, we put that cording. Sorry, I couldn't think of the word. Put the cording on the inside so that we got the curve instead of having the indent with the tacks.
So your plan is to finish up this chair off camera probably and post pictures.
Yeah, because I mean an hour of gluing GIMP and doing tacks would be pretty boring. So we will finish this off camera, post a picture of it when it's all done, and we will see all of you next week when we start on to the holiday decorating project. And for those of you that are members, we will see you this afternoon in about 90 minutes. So get your questions ready and hop on over to the website. Thanks everybody for joining us today, and I hope you have a great rest of your week.